Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Norbert Tihanyi, and I was working for the Hungarian SA more than 7 years, and I was responsible to make penetration testing and cryptanalysis, and we do some researches relating to prime number theory. And right now, I'm a senior security advisor at a Hungard company. As you can see my t-shirt, this is a green t-shirt. As you know, we didn't have such kind of cool t-shirt in the Hungarian NSA, so maybe this was the first reason why I just left the company. In this presentation, I would like to show you how to hide some backdoors and how to make some malicious code or random number generations methods, and how to identify these codes, and after that, how to implement in practice these backdoors and applications on prime number generation methods and in backdoors of random number generations. The general background of the research can be shown in these slides. And the main concept of this presentation is based on the following researches that you can see in the slides: side-channel kleptography, pseudorandom number generation. And this presentation also presented in the Central European Conference on Cryptology in Budapest relating to the mathematical background. And right now, we implemented the code. And right now, we would like to show you how to implement in the real practice and how to make some fake certificate, how to implement some sophisticated backdoors or random number generators. And this research also based fault injection-based backdoors in pseudo-random number generators. This research started within the umbrella of the Hungarian NSA, and right now we try to implement all of the codes. And this is the main reason we would like to show you how you can do it. And after the presentation, you can also get the source code of these algorithms and implementations. As you know, OpenSSL, there are a number of open source applications that are using OpenSSL library. And you know, for example, OpenSSH or curl, stunnel. And all of these applications is very important to emphasize that these applications are based on the secret of OpenSSL. So it means if you can make some backdoors in this library, or you can implement new techniques to this OpenSSL library, after that there is a chance to hide some backdoors. Of course, it's not so easy because, as you know, there are some checksums on the library, and there are many defenses how to prevent this kind of malicious activity. So the main question is, as I'm trying to show you in my presentation, that is it possible to hide the backdoor on a well-known algorithm? For example, everybody knows that RSA or AES is well-known for security experts. So it means that if you would like to make some white box audit, for example, in AES code, if you know how does it work, if you know what the algorithm is doing, and you have some test vectors, it's very easy to identify the backdoors, for example, in an encryption algorithm. It means, as you can see in the slides, for example, you have encryption key, you have an initialization vector, you have test vector, and you have a ciphertext. And if you know how AES algorithm is working on, you can make some tests. There is an input, there is an output. It's working or not. If the output is different than the sample or the text, then it means that maybe there is some backdoors on the AES algorithm, or there is some programming mistakes on the algorithm. So it means such kind of test vectors are proof of concept that modification have been made, for example, on the algorithm, and it's very difficult to hide a well-known backdoor in AES, RSA, or well-known encryption algorithm. So this was the main idea, that modification, an encryption algorithm, is lead to a non-sophisticated backdoor. So what about random number generators? As you know, there are no test vectors. It means, because the behavior of the random number generators is to produce true random numbers. Of course, if you are using only softwares, not hardwares, it's pseudo-random number generators. But, of course, you can try to make very valuable random numbers. However, you have to use some statistical tests, like the National Institute Standard of Technology test, or the DIEHARD test, in order to modify the output, or in order to test the output. If you would like to modify, there is no test vectors. It means, as I mentioned in the previous slides, if you are using AES, there are test vectors and it's working or not. In the random number generator methods, because there are no test vectors, you cannot identify the malicious code on the random number generators. Just figure out that, imagine that there is an embedded system, there are some hardware random number generation on the embedded system, and you don't know the source code, you know only the output of the random number generator. And if this random number generator passes all statistical tests, like the NIST test or DIEHARD test, it should be good random number generator, and you cannot do nothing with this. So, as you can see, the main idea, how to modify a pseudo-random number generator, for example, in an OpenSSL library, in such a way that the modified output still passes all statistical tests. I mean, if I'm modifying the random number generator, it should pass our statistical test. If not, of course, it's cryptographically not secure. So this was the main idea. And we tried to make some mathematical background relating to this topic, and we tried to implement in the practice. So the first one is just I presented in some conferences, and there is a term that how to use this kind of mathematics relating to number theory to hide some backdoors in pseudo-random number generator. And after that, you cannot identify the backdoors in the random number generator. So as you can see in the slide, that let P define a pseudo-random number generator, and let BI denote an I-bit length binary sequence. And let us define the following function, as you can see, VBI. And I wouldn't like to go into details, but it's very important relating to this topic that there is a term that there exists a polynomial time P algorithm with two of m periods. And phi PBI equals zero, it means that's observing only 2m minus 1 consecutive bits from the output of the pseudo-random number generator, it is possible to predict the next bit with 100% of success. It's very important, the next bit and 100% of success. So it's very easy to create such kind of algorithm. In these slides, there is a proof of concept algorithm relating to the AES. It's called C, self-encryption AES, and this is a POC, proof of concept algorithm. And as you can see in the slides, here is a seed. Here's an AES encryption. It's a combination of the counter mode and the CBC mode, as you can see in the slides. So the output is shifted back, and there is a new input for the next block. As you can see, that I will call capital C, because there is also a CI with this one. So capital C is this one, and the C is only this one. So capital CI plus 1 equal to the encryption key of CI. And it's, as you can see, or not see, here is the next one block, and there is no loop in the algorithm. So it means if I'm using this kind of cycle and using this kind of counter mode, it can be proved that the size and length of the self-encryption AES is minimum 2 of 128 bits, and there is no loop in the counter mode. In such a way, as you know, AES is designed in such a way that try to pass all of known, well-known statistical tests, like the National Institute Standard of Technology test, the NIST test, or the DIEHARD test. So it means if you are encrypting a pseudo-random number generator output in such a way, the output is always predictable, and the output cannot be distinguished from true random numbers only by statistical tests. So if you know the source code, if you know how this algorithm is working, you can predict the next bit with 100% of success. However, with only statistical tests, I have to emphasize that only with statistical tests, you cannot distinguish from true random numbers. And it's very interesting, relating to the proof of this proof of concept algorithm, that there is a very important corollary, as you can see in these slides. So if you would like to observing how many bits you have to observe in order to reconstruct the internal seed of the random number generator, you have to observe only 383 bits. So it's not too much to reconstruct the next bit. So it means, as you can see in this proof, that consecutive capital CI and CI plus 1 is 256 bits, of course. Always can be found in 383 bits. If you just would like to imagine this scenario, there is a slide, there is a picture, and you can check that 258 bits always can be found, only 383 bits. Relating to this one, it's only just a proof of concept code. So if someone tried to implement these codes in OpenSSL library, it's not as sophisticated, because if you have a white box audit and there is a security expert, and the security expert just try to check these combination of Contermod and CBC mode of the AES algorithm, he will definitely identify the malicious activity in this encryption method. However, it's very interesting that we just make some malware to modify the OpenSSL library and try to modify the internal state of the prime number generation. As you know, if I'm trying to modify the prime number generation, for example, in OpenSSL library, after that, there are some statistical tests that have to pass the output. So it means if I'm doing some bad prime numbers and so on and so on, after that, they really won't qualify and really don't want to pass his R statistical test in OpenSSL library. So you have to be very careful when you are modifying prime numbers generation method of the OpenSSL library. In this algorithm, you can see that it's a very interesting algorithm, that you are just searching prime numbers less than the binary length of the number is 1024. So it means you just multiply together prime numbers less than 100,000. And as maybe some of you heard about that, in 1947, John Pollard proved that is it possible to factorize very large numbers in polynomial time if, for example, if its prime factors, p minus 1 or q minus 1, has only small prime factors. Small prime factors means, for example, less than 100,000, as we see in the previous section in this slide. So it means if somebody would like to make such kind of sophisticated backdoor rating to prime number generation, they can use, for example, these techniques to generate some prime numbers. And after that, we can check that how many thank you. Okay, so after that, you just generated some prime numbers. You can test with NIST test and other sophisticated statistical tests, and passes all well-known statistical tests. It means any method that's implemented in OpenSSL library will not identify that any malicious backgrounds activity is going on in the code. In this slide, you can see that you can see a public key. Just we generated a public key with all modified OpenSSL library, and after that, We just published the public key to everybody, and as you know, it's a 2048 bits public key, and so it's almost infeasible to factorize. However, if you are using such kind of backdoors, or if you are using such kind of malicious random number generators, is it possible to reconstruct its prime numbers? There is a mistype in the slide. Can you see it? This is the public key of the previous public key. This is the decimal number of the N modulus from this public key. Of course, it is a base64 encoded version of the public key. And this is the N modulus decimal number. This is a 2048 bits number. And we just generated in such a way, as I mentioned to you, with John Pollard techniques, because we would like to reconstruct the private key from the public key. So I would like to emphasize that after that, is it possible to reconstruct the private key from the public key? And of course, if you are using only statistical tests, you cannot find any malicious activity only in the numbers, because there are no such kind of activities going on. If you know, you can also check on the internet that Polar's P-1 algorithm is pseudocode, as you can see here. The first step is select a smoothness bound B. I really wouldn't like to get into details how to select this bound, but after that, there is a very important part of the algorithm, this one, that the algorithm is running till the time limit is not reached. So it means, have you ever tried to factorize a very large number? For example, if it's large number, it's more than 2,000 bits, it means you try to factorize it and your computer is not working. There is no result, there is no result, there is no result. So it means you cannot factorize it. However, as I mentioned to you, this number, is it possible to factorize? This computer is factorized approximately 8 minutes. And is it possible to reconstruct the P and Q prime numbers? And if I'm choosing the smoothness B number larger than 100,000, for example, 1 million, 10 million, 100 million, then it means the factorization time is not 8 minutes or not 5 minutes, 1 hour, 1 day, 1 week. So it means if you are trying to factorize a large number and there is no result, you don't know why there is no result in the output, because this is a very secure, huge number, or there is a very large snooze number and generated in such a way these numbers. I really don't want to make an explanation of this algorithm. You can find also in the internet. We just used the combination of this algorithm and the combination of the previous mentioned algorithm, self-encryption AES, to produce sophisticated and very good quality random numbers in OpenSSL library. Of course, relating to the huge decimal number, within 1 minute, Core i7 laptop would found all of the prime factors of the huge numbers, so you can find P and Q less than within 1 minute. So it means that is it possible to reconstruct from the public key the private key? And it's, of course, everybody knows that it's a malicious activity, can be used in embedded system, in web pages, or when you are using some SSH or something like that. Of course, just some words relating to the NIST randomness test, that when you are modifying the OpenSSL output, that is very well-known statistical test that your generated numbers have to pass. So it means I'm just generating some bad numbers and they are not passes all statistical tests from the National Institute Standard of Technology test. It means that these numbers are failed, so you cannot use for cryptographic purposes. It's very well known. However, we tested all of these, all of the 15 and 16 and 17 tests. There are some extended tests in the niche test. So all of the 15 tests pass the output of the random number generation, and after that, we tried to modify some other numbers. We tried different approaches also. Maybe you have a word about Sharkes and Maudit theoretical tests. We also applied the well distribution, this one, and we also applied the correlation measure, this one. And after that, we didn't identify any differences between true random numbers and between the generated random numbers. So we didn't find any statistical test that can distinguish these bad numbers from good numbers. So after the statistical test, we tried to implement a real scenario, and we try to make some implementation of the code. So we just you can see the weakssl.com, and we just requested this domain, and we generated CSR and sent to Commodore that we would like to HTTPS certification. You know, we would like to use a secure communication, and we just request a certificate. And certificate issued by Commodore, Secure CA, and this is a 2048 bits encryption rating to the RSA, as you know. And it's very interesting that if you're a CA, it's not possible to identify any malicious activity in such kind of numbers, because you don't have enough researches to make factorization, to find bad behaviors in such kind of numbers. So it means after that they approved and issued the certificate, we just deployed to vkssl.com. You can check on your mobile phone also. Vkssl.com is active and it's working. Of course, you can check some SSL lab tests. Maybe you know it. That's, we try to configure the server very securely. It means A+1. You know, it's everything is enabled on this server, so it's very secure. It seems to very secure. As you can see, TLS fallback also it's enabled, and HTTPS forward secrecy is also enabled on the server. So, relating to the security certificates, everything is turned on. And the server seems very secure relating to the certification and also certified by the Commodore. As you can see in these slides, just using some very basic commands in Linux, for example, OpenSSL, S client connects, you can just download the certificate from the server. It's very easy, you can download, you can try it. And after that, you can write out the modulus, and you can write out from the certificate, which is the public key modulus. This is the huge number. And the next step is try to factorize this number. And we've written the source code in PRNG. It's a computer algebra system. It's very easy to use. Every function you have to find in relating to number theory, you can very easy write some programs relating to this topic, and you can find some very cool stuff in this program. As you can see in the presentation, and this slide, here is the modulus. This is the large 2048 bits number, and you have to factorize it. Of course, if you try to factorize a normal number, it takes more than a million years in a single computer, so you cannot do this. However, this method is generated by our sophisticated modified OpenSSL library, and after that, this is the Pollard P-1 algorithm invited by John Pollard in 1974. We wrote this program in PRNG. You can see it's a very short one. And we just try to factorize the huge number, this one. And as you can see, it takes 1 minute and 31 seconds. Within 2 minutes, we were able to factorize the huge number and the certificate. And it means that is it possible to reconstruct from public key the private key. And if you see that just, for example, like in vkssl.com, that everything is secure, the certificate is certified by a very well-known CA, and everything is configured well, maybe there is some problem with the certificate also, because you can make some such kind of bad prime numbers that can be used in such kind of certificates. Summarizing the research, it's very important to emphasize that kleptography, this is a so-called solid theory of cryptography, when you try to hide information with cryptographic methods and try to steal information, for example, from companies with cryptographic methods, it's very well known nowadays. And we just modify the OpenSSL library. However, you can use this kind of methods in embedded system. And it's very important to know that when you are using some kleptographic methods and there is a white box audit, a security expert won't identify any malicious activity, for example, in a source code. And of course, if you know that such kind of prime number generation exists and you will see the source code, you will know that there is some problem with the prime numbers. However, if you know only the outputs, for example, the certificate like in vkshshare.com, you don't have any clue how to factorize it, you don't have any clue how the prime numbers P and Q generated. So it means you can make some backdoors, you can implement some backdoors in such kind of applications like SSH or certificates. This is a working malware on Linux. It means that you can find the binaries of the OpenSSL, and is it possible to modify the binaries, and after that the prime number generation is malicious. And of course, as I mentioned to you, it's very important to emphasize that it's not possible to distinguish by statistical tests. So many random number, hardware random number generator or software random number generator try to approve in such a way that they try to analyze the output. In this way, if you're trying to analyze the output, it's not possible to distinguish from other true random number generators. Okay, thank you for your attention. If you have any question relating to random number generation or relating to the source code, I'm ready to answer it, or we can also send to you in an email to you to try it, or you can also try it to factorize vkshshl.com, or there is an SSH that is also weak in vkshshl.com. Thank you very much.
Does anybody have any questions they'd like to ask? We have a few minutes to spare.
Come on.
Nobody. You must have been very clear. Nothing. Ah, there's one gentleman.
Short question. Have you studied the topic of manipulating ECC key generation through this way?
Yeah, you mean some problems relating to advanced nodon and some elliptic curve generation methods. Yes, as you know, relating to cryptography, many huge companies like NSA or Hewlett-Packard or something like that, very huge companies, are using such kind of backdoors. And it's very interesting because when you are identifying backdoors relating to cryptography, you don't know it's really a backdoor or it's just some mistake in the mathematic programming. When I checked relating to elliptic curve, they are using not the same techniques, but some kleptographic techniques, how to hide some secret parameters relating to the elliptic curve. And after that, they try to how can I say, you know, when you are generating prime numbers, we have some statistical prime numbers generator. It means there is a chance that it's not a prime number, but it's very highly likely that it's a prime number, like Miller-Robin test or something like that. And when they are just generating some elliptic curve, they just told everybody that it's 100% secure and it's 100%, there is a little chance that there is not on the curve and something like that. And after that, some years ago, they identified that there is some problem with the curves. And this is the same techniques relating to these other number theoretic groups like elliptic curves. So they are using maybe a more sophisticated backdoors, and it's you don't have such kind of researches. You don't have many supercomputers to analyze that is really a prime number, this is really on the curve or something like that. And of course they have the research and they can make such kind of sophisticated backdoors. as I mentioned to you, my computer takes 8 minutes to reconstruct from the public key, the private key. It means I can choose a larger number, and it takes 8 days. So when you are trying to factorize, after 1 day, after 2 days, you just finish it. Okay, it's a very secure number. However, if you try to run more than 8 days, you will find the factors. So this is the same. If you don't have enough researches to find some curves on the elliptic curves and find some secret parameters, you think that everything is secure on this random number generation. However, after that, everybody tried to find the secret parameters, and everybody tried to calculate everything. After that, they found and realized that there is some problem with the random number generator.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.